Hey, what's up, Bookshelf family? And for all those joining us, you know, thank you so much for taking this time to spend with us. It's our first online broadcast, man. I'm so excited. Glory to God. You know, however you're connecting with us, I'm just so grateful for technology that we can still gather around the word. You know, it says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And so, you know, even today, I'm excited just to still be able to spend time around the word of God, because I believe that it's so important and so vitally important that in this season that we still continue to hear faith. And I believe that the Lord has something to say to us today. And I just want to take a moment. I still feel like God can be glorified. I still believe that He should be glorified in this season. I still believe that He's a good God, that He still loves us, that He's worthy of our praise, you know. And so He can, you know, He's going to cause all this to work together for our good. I don't know how He's going to do that, but I know that He's going to do it. I know that it's going to work out for our good in this season. And so I want to just, you know, there's something that we can be thankful for. There's something that we can be grateful for. So I don't want to wait for the circumstances to change before I decide, okay, now I'm going to be grateful. No, I'm going to find a reason to be grateful in this season. Amen. So invite someone to church. Like, now's a good time as any to say, hey, do you want to go to church with me? Send them the link and say, hey, I'll meet you there. I'll meet you there, you know. And I know we're not able to meet in a physical location, but that's not going to stop our expectation for God to share something and for the Holy Spirit to speak something straight to our spirits today. So if there's any distractions, like you got to guard against distractions today. And whatever it is, like if the kids are busy, if the kids are a bit of a distraction, like now's a good time to set them up in the other room, like let them go play outside for a moment as we just go in together to hear what the Lord has to say for us, even in, especially at this time. You know, I believe that the Word of God is alive, it's active. The Scripture says that it's a living letter, and I believe that it's able to meet you right where you are, right where you are. So do whatever you got to do to position yourself in expectation or just in faith so that we can get everything that the Lord has for us today. Amen. Amen. So let's pray. So Father, we just thank you. We come right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you invade every home? Would you invade every car? Would you invade every device right now? In Jesus' name, would your presence be felt tangibly right now? In the name of Jesus, we so expect and thank you for ears that hear, eyes that see, hearts that are positioned, receptive to receive what the Spirit of God is saying today. And we give you the honor, we give you the praise, we call it done in advance. And we thank you right now for all that you're about to do in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. So you got your Bibles? Well, I hope you got your Bibles. So go with me to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5. So I'm going to do a little teaching today. You know, I know you can't shout back at me, but I'm going to believe that you can still shout where you are. So go with me to Mark chapter 5. And so while you're turning there, I just want to tell you, like, we all know what's going on in the world today. Global lockdown with a global pandemic and all of these things. Man, on every platform you look at, you can see about it. And so in the midst of that, I believe, and the Lord spoke something to my heart. And if you want a title for today's message, here it is. He said this to me. He said, guard your gates. Guard your gates. So what do you mean by that? You know, I was on social media. I was just scrolling away. And it's called a news feed for a reason. It's feeding you the information. It's feeding you something. And so here I was feeding on the statistics. I was feeding on the reports. I was feeding on people's comments, even people's complaints. I was just feeding on it, and immediately the Lord arrested me and said, guard your gates. Guard your gates. And so what gates am I talking about? I'm talking about your eye gates, I'm talking about your ear gates, and I'm talking about your mouth gate. And so, like, that's why I feel like, because in such a short space of time, what was happening was these things were beginning to get into me, and I was like, hey, what's going on here? You know, and all of it, and the Spirit of God was so faithful. He said, guard your gates. Because here's the thing, what you feed on matters. What you feed on matters. And fear, I really believe, has gripped the whole world. Like, fear has gripped the world. And so that's why social media, news outlets, all kinds of, it's driven by fear. But the Lord said, guard your gates. And that's why Mark chapter 5 is so powerful, because here you had these two extreme situations. And I'm going to, just for the sake of time, you can go, it's Mark chapter 5 verses 22 to 42. And you can go and read that. I'd encourage you to go read that story. But I want to just give you the overview because of time. And so here you had Jairus, who was a local synagogue leader. And he comes to Jesus and he says, hey, would you come in and heal my daughter? And here's the amazing part. Jesus is like, yes, I will. Now, it's amazing because he had a crowd of people pressing on wanting his attention, but he would still go for the one. And it's such a display of the heart of God that he would still go for the one. And in this season, would you be that one? Could you be that one for someone? Like, I know people are hoarding and trying to get things to themselves, but could we take a minute just to find out, hey, is there anybody that's around me that needs something that I can be, that I can be a blessing to them? This is not the time to hoard, but this is the time to be a blessing. You know, it really is a time of giving, because, hey, they want to see, light shines best in darkness. And here's the thing, it's like, I love how Jesus said, yes, I'll go. And so the story goes, and his daughter dies, but Jesus still goes, raises her from the dead. That's the one extreme. The other extreme is this woman with the issue of blood. She was hemorrhaging or bleeding for 12 years. It was incurable. She said she saw like all doctors. She spent all she had, but the Bible says that she grew worse. And as you know, the story goes, and she touches the hem of his garment, and she's like instantly healed. It's an amazing story. And I believe that God has got something in this passage of scripture for us today. But the thing that really caught my attention was in verse 36. But before we get to verse 36, I want to take you back just to verse 35. And it says this. And before he had finished speaking, so this is when Jairus had just asked him, like, would you come and heal my daughter? Jesus is like, yes, let's go. The woman, it's the encounter with the woman. She gets healed. And as the woman has gotten healed, and this is where we pick up in verse 35. And before he had finished speaking, people arrived from Jairus' house and pushed through the crowd to give Jairus the news. There's no need to trouble the master any longer. Your daughter has died. Your daughter has died. Now that's some bad news. Like that's some extreme news to get. But I couldn't shake that phrase. There's no need to trouble or to bother the master, to trouble Jesus any longer. And it really got me thinking, because I was like, why did they say that? Because Jesus had told Jairus, I'm going to go and I'm going to lay hands, I'm going to heal your daughter. And here they come back with a report to say, hey, you don't need to bother him any longer because your daughter's died. And the reason why I feel like they came and they said that to him, or came and brought that report, was because they only recognized Jesus as the healer. But they failed to recognize him as the resurrection. They knew him as the healer. They heard reports about him healing. That's why Jairus even went to Jesus. But they failed to recognize him as the resurrection. Didn't he say that I am the way, the truth, and the life? He is life itself. Like, he is the resurrection. So the situations and the circumstances in your life, what they do is they give you an opportunity to see another side of who God already is. Man, that gets me excited. So this virus, this lockdown, or whatever it is that you're facing right now, may it reveal to you just another side or a different side of who God already is. And so here you have Jairus' servant, and he says this. He said, don't trouble the master any longer. But now I want you to see verse 36. Verse 36 is this. But Jesus refused to listen to what they were told. But Jesus refused to listen to what they were told. Sometimes people are going to try to give you a report that Jesus didn't say. They try to give you a report that God didn't say. And so sometimes you have to refuse to listen. You got to guard your gates. You got to refuse to listen to what you're getting told. Look at this. Jesus refused to listen what they were told and said something. He said to the Jewish official, don't yield to fear. All you need to do is keep on believing. That, my goodness, that's such a good scripture. He says, I understand the report they just, but let's ignore that. Like, don't yield to fear, which tells me that fear was very present and he had the ability to yield to fear or yield to faith, yield to fear, or yield to love. And he says, don't yield to fear. All you need to do is keep on believing. You see, fear was trying to get into Jairus' heart. Why was fear trying to get into his heart? Because Proverbs 4:23 says this. It says, above all, guard your heart, for it affects everything that you do. Another translation says, it determines the course of your life. So if fear can get down into his heart, it will begin to determine and steer the course of his life. So that's a pretty strong statement in Proverbs 4. It says, above all else. So if the word is expressing such a high importance of guarding your heart, then that tells me I have to really make guarding my heart a high priority in my life. I can't just allow anything into my heart, because above all, guard your heart, for it's going to affect everything that you do. You know, I heard the Lord say this the other day to me. He says, with understanding comes security. With understanding comes security. Now, I'm not talking about head knowledge. I'm talking about revelation. I'm talking about revealed truth. I'm talking about when light comes, like revealed truth. So with understanding comes security. So let me give you an example. So let's just say all the lights go out in your house, your road, your street, everything. Like you can't, it's so dark, you can't see your hand in front of your face. Completely pitch black. The chances of you walking around the house trying to just continue to navigate, the likelihood of you getting hurt is extremely high. But what happens when you begin to turn a light on, to shed some light on the situation? All of a sudden, the more light that comes, the more secure you feel to move around. And so it is when truth comes, when more understanding comes, when you receive light and truth, revealed truth, revelation, all of a sudden more light comes so you can be more secure by moving around. Like when you receive more truth about God's love, His protection, His provision, like as you receive more truth, may it begin to secure you more and more, especially in this season. So above all, guard your heart. So write this down if you're taking notes. A guarded heart doesn't shift away from heaven's reality. A guarded heart doesn't shift away from heaven's reality. You see, it's where you shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. But here's the beautiful part. The truth doesn't only make you free, it also keeps you free. Now here's the deal. Truth isn't facts, it's a person. Truth isn't facts, it's a person. And his name is Jesus Christ. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He is truth. So the more you get to know him, the freer you become. The more you get to know him, who's him? He is truth. So the more you get to know him, the freer you become. You see, God isn't, he's not after some religious experience. He's after relationship. Man, I want to say that again. He isn't after a religious experience. He's after relationship. He cares about you. He loves you. He wants to walk with you, talk with you. Man, he wants to comfort you. He wants to be closer to you than you ever thought someone wanted to be. He wants to be so close to you. The Apostle Paul said this in Philippians 3. He says, this is such a good scripture. He says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. The Apostle Paul was in pursuit of relationship. He was in pursuit of, I want to know him. I want to know him more and more. Like, that should be our drive. That should be our pursuit, is relationship. Because it's I get to communicate with God and he talks back to me. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. Like, how many of you know Joshua and Caleb? Joshua and Caleb. Like, they guarded their heart for 40 years, wandering around with a whole bunch of people that were in unbelief, that were fearful, that were in, like, they wandered around for 40 years. But because they guarded their hearts, they never lost sight of heaven's reality. What was heaven's reality? That's the land I've given you. What was heaven's reality? They came back and declared it. We are well able to possess the land. Let us go up at once. They knew the giants, they knew the opposition, but they said, let us go up at once, for we are well able to possess the land. Why? Because the Lord will go with us. They had heaven's reality in their heart and they would not let it go because they guarded that thing like their life depended on it. You see, what was in their heart, what was in their hearts directed the course of their life and they got to go in. So our hearts play a very crucial part in this walk of faith. The just shall walk by faith, the just shall live by faith. But you do that because of what's steering and directing the course of your life, and that's your heart. So I want to show you what's available when you guard your heart. But if you're anything like me, like I want to know how. I want to know, like, okay, Lord, like, it's all cool. Like, I hear the scripture, like, above all, guard your heart because it's going to affect everything that you do. Like, that's a good scripture, but I want to know how. I want to know how. And so the thing is this. Before things can filter down into your heart, they have to filter through your mind. And that's why guarding your gates are so important. Your eye gates, your ear gates, and your mouth gate. So before anything gets into your heart, it has to pass through your mind. Romans 12:2 says this, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The translation says the entire renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You see, because of your design, your mind can be one of the greatest blessings to you, but can also be one of the greatest curses to you. You know, Joyce Meyer says this, she calls it the battlefield of the mind. And how many of us have had that experience where you feel like there's a raging battle going on in your mind, man? Like, it's just like, wow. Like, you think to yourself, like, how is this all happening? So it can be a curse, but it can also be a blessing. So write this down. An unrenewed mind lives a very limited, natural life. Why? Because an unrenewed mind conforms to the customs, the ideals, and the opinions of the culture around it. Let me give you the Passion Translation of Romans 12:2. Stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you. Don't be squeezed into the mold of this present age. Be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. This will empower you to discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, so good, satisfying and perfect in His eyes. So here's the deal. What's influencing your thinking is going to set the limitations or the boundaries on your life. So again, an unrenewed mind lives a very limited natural life, but a renewed mind, what it does, it now illustrates what's possible in God, on earth as it is in heaven. So we want to find out what's truth, what's going on in heaven, and we want to establish that thing on earth. Oh Lord, you said there's no sickness in heaven. Okay, cool. Like, I don't see sickness in heaven, so I want to establish no sickness on earth. I see that people live in unity, live in love. Like, I want to establish that in my family. I want to establish that in my community. Like, we want to find out heaven's reality, and we want to establish that thing in the earth. Like, that's what we're after, because a renewed mind illustrates what's now possible in God. I felt the Lord say this to me a couple of months ago. He said this. He said, your thought life is one of your greatest defense systems. And naturally, I was like, oh, that sounds amazing, Lord, but why? And then he followed on and he said this to me. He said, because it has the ability to filter and block everything that is harmful for your heart. You see, your heart is what's directing and steering the course of your life. And so what gets in there is important. But did you know that you can have some doubt going on in your head, but still faith in your heart? Because it's what the heart man believes unto righteousness. It's what the heart man believes. As a man thinketh in his heart, so easy. So sometimes the thoughts can come in your mind, but here's the deal. Don't let them linger around too long to get into your heart. And so you may have like one moment you got, like, you are in faith, and all of a sudden one thought comes and throws you off and be like, okay, I can't get into faith anymore. No. It's when it gets down into your heart that it's going to affect and change the course of your life, because it's what the heart man believes. So what's in your heart matters. What's in your heart matters. I did some research and I was doing some studying just to find out like what the average person consumes. And I found this was so interesting, that the average person consumes about 105,000 words per day. 105. Now they say like that they can't read about 105,000, but it's everything that's getting filtered into their eyes and in their ears. about 105,000 words for an average person per day. Now, and I get this, after you add pictures, video games, movies, or whatever it is, you can reach a volume of, get this, plus minus 34 gigs of information per person per day, an average. Like, if you don't know what 34 gigs means, lean over to the person next to you and say, is that a lot? Because 34 gigs is a lot of information to take in one day. And now you add a global pandemic, you add this global focus, like imagine the amount of information that's coming at you all day long. And then you're still expected to stay in faith by receiving all this negative or fear and fear-driven information. It's not that the information or some of the information is invalid, but it's like you're taking so much information in. It's like it's gonna produce fear. And so here's the deal. Like, you have a mind and you have a heart. So you can't always choose the thoughts that are coming into your mind. Because how many of you know you can be sitting, no phones, there's no devices on whatsoever. You can be sitting in total silence and thoughts come out of nowhere. Like, just come out of nowhere. But so you got a mind. So sometimes it's crazy, like it goes on there, but you have the ability to limit or filter it based on what you're looking at and listening to. But even still, you'll still have some thoughts that are not your thoughts. And you can, but you get to choose. You have the authority to choose what goes down into your heart. And so God showed me like a very simple illustration about like your eye gates, your ear gates, and your mouth gate. And so I just want to show you this illustration. So if you look at it, you'll see like on the sides is the ear gates, and on the top is the eye gate, and at the bottom is the mouth gate. And so you have the eye gates. You know, it says take in what you see. And Jesus only did what he saw. He says that Jesus only did what he saw his Father do. And that's in John chapter 5. He only did what he saw his Father do. So what you're looking at matters. Like, we can't be spending 90% of our time on social media watching scary horror movies or whatever it is and wonder why we're mad all the time, why there's so much fear in our hearts, so much, or depressed or anxious because we may be consciously or subconsciously looking at somebody else's highlight reel and wondering why we're feeling the way we feel. You know, Matthew 6:22 says this, If your eye be single, your whole body will be full of light. If your eye be single, your whole body will be full of light. So what you look at matters. And then you get the ear gates. The Bible says, take heed what you hear. What you hear in Mark chapter 4. Take heed what you hear. Jesus said this. He says, I don't speak of my own authority. The Father who sent me has commanded me what to say and how to say it. What to say. So even Jesus was in relationship with the Father. So he was hearing what the Father was saying, and that's what he was saying. And so faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. So if faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, I believe that what you're listening to matters. So if you're hearing faith comes. But what happens if you're hearing fear, if you're hearing doubt, unbelief? Like, what happened? What's happening is those things, you still doubt, fear, unbelief can also come by hearing the wrong things. So what you are listening to also matters. And so if you look at this, if you look at that picture again, and you see like the outer court and the inner court and the holies of holies. And so the way the Lord explained this or gave it to me in my heart was he referred it back to the temple, where you had the gates obviously to come in, but then you had the outer court. And the outer court generally was very busy, was noisy, like there was a lot of stuff going on in there. And so for this, the way he showed me this was like your outer court, like you can easily notice like straight up lies. Like it's noisy, like it's a lot going on there. And that's sort of where all the information comes in all at once, like it's all busy in there. But here's the thing, even though you recognize the lie, you don't let it linger there just because you've recognized, you still got to get rid of it. And then you have the inner court, which is that yellow ring. And it's there were less people allowed into the inner court. So you had a lot of people, then you had less people. So even in the inner court of your mind, or in going down towards your heart, it may be less noisy or quiet, or as some of the voice may even be a lot more subtle. What I mean by that, like you may be still hearing whispers now of saying, hey, you're not going to make it, or hey, you're not qualified enough for that job, or you know what, like your parents were like that, so that's just your lot in life. Oh no, you're it's just a generational thing with you. No, don't allow those lies to linger around. Like you've been given the authority not to allow those lies into your heart. And then lastly, you have the holies of holies, which is your heart. And that's what's steering the course of your life right now. So how do we defend these lies from getting into our heart? How do we do that? Because that's what we want to know. How do we guard our heart? You got to defend lies with words. You have got to defend lies with words. Never try to fight the battle in your mind. You're going to lose. Why? Because you weren't designed to fight it in your mind. You were designed to function like your father. In the beginning, God said, he said that he saw. So you, and that brings me to the last gate, the mouth gate. And so what you are declaring matters. What you've been given the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. It's a weapon that you can use. So when you take the truth, you use the truth. You defend the lies with truth, with a word, with words. So you use your mouth to declare truth. You use your mouth to say, hey, those thoughts that's coming, those are not my thoughts. I cast down imaginations and every high thing which tries to exalt itself against the true knowledge of God. I bring captive every thought to the obedience of Christ. And then you go on a rampage and you're like, hey, this is the truth. Now I'm going to declare truth. These are my thoughts. My thoughts are lovely. They're good. They're just. They're of a good report. They're virtuous. They're of integrity. These are the things I think on. So you defend those lies with truth. And the more truth you speak, the quieter the lies become until they disappear. And that's what you allow to filter down into your heart. So notice the woman with the issue of blood, right? She had this incurable disease. She had this hemorrhaging going on for 12 years. But I want you to notice the moment that changed her life forever. It's found in verse 27. It says this, when she heard about Jesus. When she heard about Jesus. I know that may be too simple for some people, but when she heard about Jesus, I still believe that Jesus is the answer. He's the answer to every situation that we go through. He's the answer to every problem that we have in the world today. He is still the answer today, tomorrow, and forever. He is still the answer. So when she heard about Jesus, what did she hear? She heard truth. And out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth began to speak. So no longer, I can't see it. I can't find it in the scripture. No longer did she keep saying, oh, I'm never going to get healed. I'm just going to be sick until I die. No. She, look at this. When she received truth, her language changed. And so when you receive truth, your language needs to begin to change. And that's why I say you defend lies with truth. You defend lies with words. And so her language began to change. Notice in verse 28, she says this, for she kept saying to herself, if only I could touch his clothes, I know I will be healed. For she kept saying to herself, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God, I know I will be healed. I know I will be healed. If I can only touch his clothes, I know I will be healed. For she kept saying to herself, this is what she kept saying to herself, if only I could touch his clothes, I know I will be healed. That's an extreme from, like, for the last 12 years, she's only ever known life a certain way. She's only ever known sickness. She's never known health for the last 12 years. But when she heard about Jesus, her entire language began to change. Now she began to function like she was designed. She began to function, to begin to call those things which be not as though they were. She began to function in her design. You made in the image and the likeness of God, so you were made to function like him. And God spoke. So now you look at your artist though. Now you look at Jairus. He had every opportunity to open up his mouth based on the report that he was given, like, don't bother the master, like your daughter's died. So he had every opportunity to open up his mouth, but I needed to see this. But based on what Jesus said, see, it's God's after this relationship. Based on what Jesus said, he remained silent. And sometimes the wisest thing that we can do is after we have heard God say, after we have received the promise of God, after we have declared the promise that he had spoken, he says, my word goes out, it shall not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which I desire. Like, when God's word goes out, sometimes the wisest thing that we can do is remain silent. Man, that's so good. Like, because what the enemy wants to do is he wants you to speak against your promise. He wants you to speak against what you're believing for. And that's why God wants relationship and not formula. Because he's already made a way of escape. So he's going to tell you which exit to take, who, like, what to say, when to say, when to be quiet. He's going to give you, he's going to direct you. And so this woman with the issue of blood and Jairus, they both had the opportunity to speak against what they were believing for, but they had a choice to make, and the woman chose to say something that was building her faith, because faith comes by hearing. And so as her faith got built up, she got to the point where her faith could lay a hold of what was available. So like her faith, man, that's so good. Like her faith got to the point where she could lay a hold of what's available. And then if you read further on in scripture, because of what she did, other people were now, they were like, I just need to touch Jesus, like his clothes, and I'm gonna be healed. Go and read, like, go further down in the script, like, you'll see it. It's so good, like, what faith was able to do. But she had to keep hearing and hearing and hearing. So she had to keep speaking that thing so her own faith could be built up to the, so that she could lay hold of it. And then the other one, which was Jairus, where based on what Jesus said, he was quiet. And so somebody was still declaring something, but which position did you need to remain in? But that's why you need relationship. And so here's the amazing part. They were both right. They were both right, and they both received what they were believing for, because faith still pleases God today. Glory to God. So, you know, as you guard your gates, especially in this season, I need you to remember, guard your eye gates, guard your ear gates, and guard your mouth gate. Because what you choose to look at matters. What you choose to listen to matters. And what you choose to say, what you choose to declare, like, it matters, man. You know, I see on social media, you know, I see all of, like, people have, like, this fitness challenge going on. And it's great, like it's amazing, get on it. But I've got a challenge for you. I've got a challenge for the next week or however long you want to take this challenge. I want to challenge for you. I want to challenge you to stay off everything that I want to challenge you to stay off everything that sows fear, doubt, anxiety, depression, oppression. Anything that you're looking at that sows doubt and fear or oppression. Anything that sows that into you, that filters that into you, you turn it off. Anything that you're listening to, whether it's music or whatever that puts fear into you, depression into you, anxiety into you, any of those things, turn it off. Like, we have to. You have to be aggressive in this season to guard your gates against anything that doesn't build your faith. So you want a faith challenge? Let's call it a faith challenge. Let's call it a guard your gates challenge. You go and guard your gates this week about everything that so that you can just have your faith built. Guard your eye gates, guard your ear gates, guard your mouth gate. And nobody can do that for you. Nobody can do that for you. So as you choose to guard your gates, like, watch your language begin to change. Notice after a few days if your language has changed. I bet your language will change. And so when your heart is speaking a different language, your entire being, your entire life begins to take on a different course. So, like, above all, guard your heart, because it's going to affect everything that you do. But you guard your heart by guarding your gates. And you have been given the authority because you've how you've been designed to guard your gates. Amen. Amen. So let me pray for you. Father, I just come now in Jesus' name, Lord. I thank you for who you are, Lord. I thank you that you are still a good Father. I thank you for the sacrifice of Jesus. I thank you for hope. I thank you that you are our hope, that you are our anchor, that we are secure in you, that we can still trust you. Lord, I just declare and I speak peace, the peace of God over everyone watching now, over everyone listening. The peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, to flood their hearts and their minds right now in Jesus' name. May hope arise in this season. May faith arise in this season. Isaiah 60 says this: arise, shine, for your light is coming. The glory of the Lord is risen upon you. May the glory of the Lord rise upon you. May you arise in this season. May you shine in this season. May the glory of the Lord be risen upon you. Know that God is for you in this season in Jesus' name. He's ever present in your time of need. Lord, would you awaken something in all of our hearts as we humble ourselves before you, Lord. Comfort all those who are hurting in this time. Be close to them, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you got something out of the word today. I really do. But before we go, man, if you don't know Jesus, if you don't have that relationship that we were talking about, remember the woman with the issue of blood? Like, when she heard about Jesus, man, her entire life changed. Her entire life changed. And so, like, if that's you, if you want to receive him into your heart today, I'm not talking about religion, I'm talking about a relationship. One thing that I've discovered is that you will never lose what you entrust to God. And you can trust God with your life. You know, I gave my life to the Lord, and what he did was he gave me his purpose for my life. And I wouldn't trade it. I wouldn't have it any other way. I wouldn't give that up for anything in the world. You see, like, what God wants to do in you and through you is far beyond what you can think, or you can dare to imagine what God wants to do in your life and through your life. Like, really, like, I'm so grateful that I don't have to earn salvation. Like, I don't think I would have made it in. Like, if it was based on my works, if it was based on how good I am or how many good deeds I did, I don't think I would have made it in. But I'm so grateful that it was that he paid the full price, and that all I had to just surrender my heart and receive his amazing grace. Like, I just had to receive him. You know, it's just today is the day of salvation. So I don't want you, you don't have to wait. You don't have to wait. You don't need to do anything special. You'll never be good enough. You'll never earn it. But God is saying to you today, all you need to do is come as you are. Or maybe you've drifted away from God. Or, you know what, maybe you've just even turned your back on God because you've been hurt, or hurt by the church, or hurt by Christians. You know, and even in this moment, I want to take an opportunity just to ask, would you forgive me? Would you forgive me on behalf of those that have hurt you? Would you forgive us? You know, I know that that God has never stopped loving you. He's waiting for you to come back home. You know, he really is. I said this to the Lord. I said this, Lord, when I got born again. I said, hey, Lord, like, and I spoke just like this. I didn't know. I just said, Lord, like, I'm going to give this Christian thing, like this being born again thing, I'm going to give it everything that I got. But if this thing doesn't work, or it isn't what you say it is, I can always go back. Like, I was fully convinced I could just always go back. But it was the greatest decision of my life. Like, and you know why? Because he's never let me down, and he won't ever let you down. And so would you let me pray with you today? Like, if you're with family, if you're with a group of friends, or even if you're on your own, like, can we just all join and pray this prayer together? Because I believe that we are definitely stronger together, especially in prayer. Especially in prayer. So would you pray this with me? Father, thank you for sending Jesus just for me. I believe you lived and you died and rose again on the third day. Forgive me of my sin. Change my life. Renew me. Transform me. Live your life in me and through me. Reveal purpose and destiny to me. I'm yours. Thank you for your peace. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your joy. Thank you, Lord. I am saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Man, can somebody give the Lord the biggest shout of praise? Man, all of heaven is rejoicing for you today. If you with your friends or your family and that you just made that decision, would you just embrace them? Would you give them a hug? Would you just celebrate with them? And hey, like, connect with us, get a hold of us. Like, we'd love to pray with you. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to share what next steps you can take in this walk. And just, hey, we just want to connect and we just want to celebrate you. We just want to celebrate you for what you've done, because I believe it is the greatest decision that you could ever make in your life. Amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us for our very first online broadcast. Whoop, whoop. Like, man, I'm so happy. And us here at the workshop, man, know that we love you. We are praying for you. And I'm believing, and we are believing for you to come out of this season stronger than you ever have, and stronger than when you went in, that you're going to come out stronger. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, I hear you whisper. Can you close?
For you, trying to find the courage to want to regret not taking the step toward my purpose. I'm waking up, taking a new perspective. The night was long until I got the message. You're moving the stillness, you're moving the stillness, closing the distance. Now I can feel it, now I can feel ya. Ooh, wow. Your voice isn't hidden, your voice isn't hidden. I just gotta listen. Listen. I hear